Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome back to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. We're here with Adam Rosko and Jesse Graff of Atomic Arts, a theater company right here in Portland, Oregon. Your new project is a stage adaptation of Nosferatu, which, I'm going to see if I can get this correct. Nosferatu is a stage production of a film which was itself a sort of bootleg adaptation of Bram Stoker's Dracula, I think.
Yes.
Maybe I've got this right, maybe I don't.
We are adapting the 1922 silent film, which was done not using the rights of the Bram Stoker story. So they changed some things, they changed the character names, the name of the creature, and we are using that version basically because it's the best, I think the best interpretation of the creature.
And this is the Max Schreck,
It
was depicted in Shadow of the Vampire with Willem Dafoe.
Right.
And this is an iconic image that a lot of people, even if people don't think they've seen Nosferatu, they probably have. There's the woman asleep and the long sort of skinny hand with the shadow going across her, and the sort of bat-like vampire. And I'm kind of a bad geek because I've never really seen it all the way through. And I feel like there's this massive hole in my cultural knowledge where I should have seen it.
But you've seen some of it and you recognize it. It's a movie that not a lot of people have seen, but then also it's so iconic.
Yeah, you've at least seen the shadow coming up the stairs, the hand reaching for the doorknob.
And even if you haven't seen it, you know the story. It's pretty much the story of Dracula.
It was an unauthorized version, and someone told me that the film itself, Nosferatu, was that it was either taken off the market or someone attempted
Stoker's wife
tried to have it destroyed the master tapes.
Yeah, she sued over the copyright infringement because they never actually got the copyright. So it was pretty much a blatant ripoff of Stoker's Dracula. So they were ordered to be destroyed. Technically, but of course some of it survived.
So how does that affect you guys if it was an unauthorized work then? How does that affect
they
you now?
They destroyed all the copies, but over the years more have surfaced, and every time that they find more, they redo the whole thing and they put out a DVD or something. But nowadays, it's completely, the story of Nosferatu is completely in the public domain. So, anyone can adapt it. That's why you see, like, you go to the dollar bins at Big Lots, there's Nosferatu DVDs, because anybody can put it out. The Herzog one is different, and there have been several official DVDs, but it's still public domain.
But this is a little bit like the original Night of the Living Dead,
where
it doesn't get copyrighted, or the copyright lapses, and then suddenly everybody and their brother can put out their own version of it.
Yeah.
Public domain really is a bit of it's a kind of a mixed blessing there, because it does allow for a lot of things. It's a Wonderful Life, I think, fell into public domain for a while, which is why it was shown constantly throughout the 60s and 70s and 80s, why everybody saw it. But at the same time, obviously the artist loses a bit of control of their work. What appeal do you said it's the definitive telling of the vampire story or of Dracula? In what ways is it definitive?
It's more, to me, the look and the attitude of the creature. It seems ever since the Lugosi version of the vampire story, he's always been this romantic, you know, good evening, I am come Dracula, you know, come have sex with me. And I like the,
It's very awkward. I mean, not that I'm not flattered, don't
It's always been a very sexy
dashing
thing, and dashing and debonair to be a vampire. You want to be a vampire, you want to be with a vampire. This is a story more in line with what Stoker originally intended, that you don't want to be this guy. You don't want to be anything about this.
And they're creatures. They are animals.
Yeah,
vampires aren't sexy.
He's so removed from basic humanity that he's just absolutely terrifying when he walks into a room, or you speak with him.
Now, Jesse, you are.
I am the vampire. Yeah, I'll shave my head on Friday.
I was actually going to ask about that. About what sort of physical or costume based or makeup based transformation you have to go through to.
There's going to be shaving the head because we're in a very intimate theater, to put it mildly. That it seats like 40 people, so like the bald cap thing isn't going to pull it off in this space. Shaving the head, ears, fangs,
the nails.
Got to be more pale than I already am.
And what is it about vampires, do you think, that has such an eternal hold on people? They really do seem to be, we're in a bit of a vampire renaissance now.
Yeah.
But why always the vampires? What is the essential allure there?
I I don't really, at least for me, I think the whole idea of the immortality aspect, and how does one deal with that? Do they use it for good, or is it like this, or is it a curse that you're plagued with being, you know, going like they said in the play, going around saying the same things, doing the same things. You've lost all your humanity by living so much of it. I think it is really interesting concept to play
yeah,
with.
Yeah, after hundreds of years, anyone you cared about to begin with is dead and gone, mm-hmm. Multiple times over, a lot of the time. So it's yeah. What is that? What does the whole immortality thing imply? And what does it do to somebody? And
yeah.
Obviously, in Nosferatu, you know, he isn't taking it so well.
He's dealing poorly.
Yeah.
Talking to Adam Rosko and Jesse Graff, they are from Atomic Arts. Their new production is a stage version of Nosferatu. They also did Star Trek in the Park, about which we will talk more in a moment when Outlook Portland returns right here on Northwest 32 TV. Stay there.